हेलो हेलो चलेगा चलेगा।
या सर
Thank you.
हेलो बोल
या सर, यू आर ऑडिबल
इंद्र
सर।
साथ
सर
में है वो तो थोड़े से छोटे गोष्ठी और भाई कुछ लेंगे।
ऐसी वैसे ढक्कन टाइम पास।
Prashant, who are answering today? Hello, Prashant. Prashant, who are answering today?
Hello, good evening, sir. Mrigank here.
So who are answering today?
Sir, I will be answering.
Hello, I can't hear.
Hello, good evening, sir. Hello.
Prashant.
Yes, sir. Today we have Sir Manas, Dr. Manas from Nilavati Hospital and Dr. Mrigank.
And Dr.
Mrigank, Vijayawada.
Acha, Mrigank.
Yeah, Prashant sir, Dr. Manas Ranjan.
Yes. Make him co-host, please.
Yes, sir.
Good evening, Pankaj.
Good evening, Gaurang Bhai.
So everything was now the trip? Okay? Our trip was really good. We enjoyed.
When did you return?
Yesterday evening. We came yesterday evening. So today Dr. Gita had come for inspection.
For inspection, okay.
21 hours. So he finished real hard work. Finished at 6 o'clock. Yeah. To get all the documents and everything, you know. Coordinator was
everything.
And this was the first DNB inspection in this year. In Lansing. So he was not prepared for all this. But anyway, we could manage it. So you will be getting now students in March, April, correct? March.
I think so. After next exam.
So today we have got Manas and Mrigank. These two are going to answer.
Good.
And this topic is your fabric again, urolithiasis. You know, I am waiting when the prostate is there and when the stone is there, I know that I have got to stalwart. And when malignancy is there, again, I am not worried. Because Ganesh is there. You know, Ganesh has left and now he has joined Hinduja.
Hinduja, I am aware of that.
Yeah.
Yes.
We'll just wait for 2-5 minutes. Dr. Venkat will also join. You know what happened? Initially, our flight was cancelled.
Yeah, you had told me.
Sir, good evening.
Good evening, Dr. Gita. Kaise?
Good evening. You must be tired.
Sir, aapne pura din bhar thaka diya. Subah 9 baje shuru karke 6 baje khatam hua.
Too much.
So it is 9-hour inspection of one department.
I know.
Really huge.
केतन देसाई सर आपको याद कर रहे थे सर,
क्या केतन देसाई का
अंकल सर को याद कर रहे थे?
अच्छा अच्छा अच्छा
केतन वॉज हाउ मेनी इयर्स सीनियर टू यू पंकज?
थ्री बैचेस सीनियर.
अच्छा, सो व्हेन यू जॉइन जेजे ही वाज नॉट देयर और
ही वाज जस्ट लीविंग, ही हैड फिनिश्ड हिज एग्जाम एंड पोस्ट एग्जाम ही वाज देयर फॉर few months.
Oh, okay, okay. But so basically he is a
friend, Shishir Jirge, who is at Kolhapur.
Huh. Is it last night?
हेलो मिस्टर राकेश. हेलो
यस सर.
आप प्लीज प्लीज मैं डॉक्टर हिरेन सोडा सर को
I think Prashant, another 2-3 minutes and we can start.
Yes, sir. We'll start, sir, after 2-3.
Hiren has joined?
Sir, yes, he has joined, sir.
Yes, sir, good evening.
Good evening, Hiren. I know you must be tired.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening, Pankaj, sir.
Good evening, Hiren.
Yes, sir.
Good evening, sir.
अच्छा ये रन प्लेजेंट आवाज है, चालू रखिए. तो उनकी आवाज से तो बेहतर है.
से गुड इवनिंग टू एवरीबॉडी.
बोलो
हेलो
Fine. I think Prashant will start.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So today we have got two people answering. One is Manas and second is Mriganta.
Yes.
Both of them are audible.
Hello, Dr. Mriganta.
Hello.
Dr. Manas.
Yes. Yes, I can hear you.
Yes.
Where are they from? Manas and...
So Dr. Manas is from Leelavati Hospital.
Okay.
And Dr. Mriganta is from Vijayawada.
Very nice.
Should we start, sir?
Yeah.
Yes. Good evening, everyone.
Talk little louder.
Okay. Yes, sir. Good evening, everyone. Welcome to Clinics for PG Update, an educational initiative by Dr. Gaurang Shah and Dr. Venkat Gite. Chief complaint, 37-year-old lady, resident of Virar, nurse by occupation, Hindu by religion, married since last 10 years, came with chief complaint of history of right-sided flank pain since 1 month.
Okay, so Manas, this is the main chief complaint. So what are the questions you like to ask?
Hello.
Manas? Yeah, Manas.
Hello, Dr. Manas. Dr. Mrigank?
Hello. Yes.
Mrigank, you can answer.
Yes, sir. So she presented with right-sided flank pain since screen is on. So I would like to ask whether the pain is associated with fever, hematuria, vomiting, nausea, whether there is any association of burning micturition.
First we have to elaborate the chief complaint.
Yes, sir.
So what is the type of pain? Is it caudal pain, colic pain? Is that pain is referred? Is that pain is radiating? Is that pain is sudden onset? Is that pain is continuous? Is that pain is intermittent? Then it is associated with vomiting, nausea, and associated with hematuria. So you have to talk about pain first and later on, then associated symptoms. So you should talk about pain first.
Yes, sir. What are the relieving factors and what are the aggravating factors for the pain, if any?
Yeah, agreed.
See, always there are six or seven factors which you have to talk about the pain. Because this is either you'll get a long case or you'll get a short case. Usually it's like a short case nowadays we get. So you should know in one sentence you must finish.
Agreed, sir.
Right. So Manas, can you hear us? Is he muted or unmuted?
I'll call him, sir.
Okay. Fine. Prashant, go ahead.
Okay, sir. In history of present illness, patient having history of right-sided flank pain. She of flank pain 1 month back. It was a sudden colic pain. In right flank, which was radiating to back and intermittent, moderate to severe in intensity and gradually increased over the period. And she has taken medication for pain relief. She was not admitted. Again, she had similar episode 7 days back and she has taken medication for pain relief. There is no history of fever. There is no history of hematuria. There is no history of vomiting. There is no history of aggravating, any aggravating or relieving factor. There is no history of burning micturition. There is no history of passing stone in urine. There is no history of similar episode before 1 month. There is no history of any passing of large amount of urine and relief of the pain. There is no history of any palpable mass in abdomen. There is no history of trauma. Hello.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Fine. So, Mriganka,
yes,
from sir. This history, probably what are the differential diagnoses that come into your mind?
So, one, it could be due to a stone in the upper ureter or kidney. The other could be due to infection.
Why you want to put your... Why you want to say only stone in upper ureter or in
the kidney? With only... Sir, with only pain for 1 month, at the end of history of present illness, again there are remaining 2 points. That is, always you should ask about history of hematuria, history of trauma, history of lower urinary tract symptoms, history of recurrent UTIs, and while telling the provisional diagnosis, why stone only 1 month pain, and that is again of back pain or not colicky pain, na?
Yes, sir.
Colicky pain. So why there is a colicky pain? That is the first question. And why stone? Because any obstruction to the any tubular structure. That means it may be appendix, it may be CPD, it may be gallbladder, it may be ureter, any tubular structure when get obstructed, that will present as a colicky pain. So why there is a colicky pain? Can anybody explain why there is a colic, the ureteric obstruction? It may be due to stone, it may be due to stricture, it may be due to malignancy, n number of causes, why ureteric stone? Manas,
have you joined? Okay.
Hello.
Manas seems
muted. Actually, he joined, sir, but I called him. He said he is not able to hear anything. I told him to log out and log in again.
Pragyanka ko
bolo. Okay.
Yeah.
So my question is why he has told. First diagnosis is a stone.
Sir, because it's a colicky pain and it's most common pathology that causes flank pain. One of the most common pathology.
He doesn't have any history of previous stone disease. He doesn't have any history of hematuria. Only 1 month history. He doesn't have any history of fever. So it can be anything.
So, Dr. Gita is asking you, what is the probable differential diagnosis?
Stone disease is one of the differential diagnoses. What are the other differential diagnoses?
Due to PUJ obstruction, it could be due to pelvic inflammatory disease, PID in female. It could be due
PID.
To cycle.
Why PID will cause pain in the plant?
Sir.
And why someone will place the PID case to the urology exam?
Don't invite trouble. Be straightforward.
You should be very, very particular. If same question asked to me in exam,
yes, sir.
1 month colicky pain, my probable diagnosis agreed. Any obstructive disease on that side. It may be benign, malignant,
yes.
Benign may stone disease, stricture, kuch bhi rahe.
Yes.
Simple.
Yes, sir. Yes.
ठीक है ना?
Yes, sir.
ऐसा दो एक दो या फिर just एक renal cyst रह सकता है जो got infected हो गया.
Yes, sir. Renal cyst.
Tuberculosis का history आगे बाप आपको पता नहीं है कहाँ calyx block हो गया hydrocalyx जो pain कर.
Renal cystic disease, yes.
अब ये तुमको broad mind से सोचना है क्योंकि if you reset mindset, if you are decided, if you know the diagnosis, then it is getting, you will get in trouble.
Okay, sir.
And that next question is why there is colic?
Sir, colicky pain due to stretching of the renal pelvis and capsule?
No, that is the cause for renal pain. This answer is for, this is the answer for question why there is, what is the cause for renal pain. So renal pain is always dull and continuous and it is not colic. And that pain may be due to the stretching of the capsule.
Yes.
My question is why there is colic pain. So the colic means some smooth muscle is contracting and try to overcome the obstruction.
Obstruction, yes, sir. Oh.
So the bolus of the urine when due to peristalsis come from pelvis to that particular area, that bolus pressure is tried to overcome the obstruction by having exaggerated smooth muscle contraction.
Yes, sir.
That will present as a colic. Why there is vomiting associated with uretary colic?
So,
these are all simple basic MBBS MS questions. So what?
Yeah, tell us.
No vasovagal. There is a reflux spasm of the pylorus. Yeah, agreed. Reflux pylorus spasm is the cause for one. Okay.
Fine.
What next?
Okay. Next. Prashant, go ahead.
बहुत सारा डायग्नोसिस आ सकता है जैसे कि एक्टोपिक यूरेट्रा में प्रेजेंट डुप्लेक्स सिस्टम उसके बाद में यूरेट्रोसील यूरेट्रिक स्टोन एनीथिंग कैन बी पॉसिबल एट दिस स्टेज
टुडे प्रोसेस
मानस कैन यू हियर अस नाउ अनम्यूट मानस
यस सर ही इज अनम्यूट ओके
Manas, can you hear us? Anyway, let's go ahead.
Yes,
okay.
Sir, in past history, patient is known case of hypertension since last 10 years and on medication for the same. There is no history of diabetes mellitus. There is no history of COTS or COTS contact. There is no history of any surgery in past. In personal history, patient's bowel bladder habits are normal. In patient takes mixed diet. Family history not significant. Menstrual history, patient's having normal regular menstruation. And patient bleed for four days. Obstetric history married since 10 years. And she is having two issues.
Okay. Fine. Mriganka, now next.
Yes, sir.
So this is a history. What else you want to know?
Sir, any history of passage of stone in past lituria?
No, he said no lituria, na? And no is similar in past.
Yes, sir.
So anything else you want to know now? Or you want to go ahead?
Sir, I want to go ahead.
Okay.
Sir,
go ahead.
Yes,
general, finish
yes,
it.
Sir. Yes, sir. In general examination, patient is averagely built, adequately nourished. Patient is conscious, cooperative. Temperature is normal. Pulse is 90 per minute. Blood pressure in right arm supine position is 130/80. Respiratory rate is 20 per minute. There is no pallor, icterus, clubbing, cyanosis, lymphadenopathy, and edema of the feet. Skull and back examination normal. Systemic examination, should I read, sir?
Yeah, finish it.
Yes, sir. In systemic
so there examination, is nothing much in
this, huh? Yes, sir. In systemic examination, on per abdominal examination, on inspection, abdomen is normal. There is no scar sinuses. On palpation, abdomen is soft, non-tender, no mass palpable. Renal angle tenderness is absent. Kidneys are non-bilatable. Respiratory system normal. CNS normal. CV system normal. No abnormality.
Yeah. Okay. Now make Manas co-host.
Hello. Sir, am I audible now?
Yes. Yeah, you're yes. audible now. Okay.
Yeah. Sorry for the minor glitch. Sir.
Yeah. So now Manas, this is a history. You know.
37-year-old lady. And she's having right
basically
flank
she
pain.
Has got only pain and the loin pain, and yes, there is no associated any other history. Everything is negative. So now what is your probable diagnosis?
So right flank pain with no associated anything. So can be either renal colic or maybe cholecystitis. Pain due to cholecystitis or cholelithiasis.
Now we are appearing appearing for urology. So mainly think of that and give us a differential diagnosis of right flank pain because of urological causes.
Sir, so it may be obstructive because of obstructive causes. So maybe due to an upper. Yes, sir. Hello.
If same patient came to you in your OPD, what is your diagnosis?
Yes, sir. So either
don't tell theory and don't tell non-urological but until an otherwise it is asked by the doctor.
Yes, sir. So either it is renal colic due to maybe an obstructive calculus at the level of PUJ or any level at the ureter.
I want to ask Dr. Gita sir and Pankaj Maheshwari, shall they say renal colic?
Yeah, I'm coming to that point only. I'm telling that point only. Renal colic is a misnomer. So renal is not a colic. Renal is pain, renal pain. Colic is always for the, already I explained, colic is always for the tubular structure, blockage of tubular structure. And kidney is not a tubular.
So they should say
so renal colic is a pain. Yeah, either urinary colic or renal pain.
Yeah. Dr. Pankaj, what is your view
renal
on
is always the neck.
Pankaj, yes, sir. I would accept the diagnosis of pain related to urolithiasis, quelli, renal colic, obvious oblique uretic colic.
My question here is, do we say it like a renal colic or renal pain? Because colic is for the only tubular structure. And renal colic is a misnomer used by the urologist.
True. In the history, we have said that patient had two episodes of colicky pain, flank pain. So, yes, I think theoretically speaking, what you are saying is right, that it is renal pain related to urolithiasis.
Agreed.
Fine. So I think best thing is to say that most probably it is because of urolithiasis, yes, looking at the history. In case if the examiner asks you again and again, so what is your differential diagnosis, then you can add a couple of things more, correct?
The first diagnosis probably will be renal pain, secondary to the stone. Second diagnosis will be PUJ obstruction. Third diagnosis will be any cystic disease. And fourth diagnosis, any obstruction in the urinary tract. From bladder to kidney. It may be ectopic ureter, it may be ureterocele, it may be ureteric tincture, anything.
Fine. Okay. So, Manas, now this is a history. The general examination, everything is over. So, now what you want to do?
Sir, I would like to do an imaging to confirm my diagnosis.
So, tell us what you want to do. Patient has come to you in OPD.
Yes, sir.
What are the investigations you will advise?
When you say imaging, means you want to do MRI?
I would like to do a CT KUB, plain CT KUB.
Why not an ultrasound?
Sir, most suspicious, suspecting, the most common diagnosis which I am suspecting is a renal, is a urolithiasis. So, CT scan being the most sensitive investigation, I would like to go ahead with it. Sir.
But still, you have not ruled out other causes. Na? Gitesh sir said, more causes can be there.
Manas, practically speaking, you may be right, but again, from exam point of view, probably this is not the correct way of answering.
I agree.
Okay, so what I would in your place say is that other than basic investigations like CBC urine routine, creatinine, sugar, yes, I would get a sonography done. Sonography can nearly be considered as an extension of your clinical examination. So nobody can fault you for doing sonography, but you can be extensively questioned for not doing a sonography.
Okay, sir.
So I would strongly feel don't skip sonography. And even in our day-to-day practice, do we directly jump to CT scan?
No, sir. In our day-to-day practice, we always do first sonography before going ahead.
Talk about what you do on day-to-day basis. No?
Yes, sir.
Agreed.
See, the examiner is what you do day-to-day. All the examiners will, they want to hear what is your institute is doing and what you will do when you start your practice. Yes. As Dr. Pankaj Maheshwari said, and previously also every time we have said, you will do routine
ultrasonography of the kidney, ureter, and
you would like to do urine and blood test also. No?
Yeah, CBC. Yeah, other than that, I would like to do basic blood investigation, CBC, creatinine, and urine routine.
Okay. So now you don't want to do X-ray QB?
Yes, X-ray QB also.
Is there any role of X-ray QB?
Yes, sir.
Bregankar?
Yes, to know the stone that radiolucent to opaque. So to know the spinal anatomy, spinal structure.
There is a lot of background noise that I can't hear. Can you be a bit more loud?
Sir,
Brigham, you can come near to the
yes, sir.
Microphone and talk.
X-ray KUB to know whether the stone is radiolucent or radio-opaque, and also to know the spinal anatomy. Is there any kyphosis, scoliosis present, which might make the if in future we plan a surgery that might
see Manas and Mriganka. First, you did not say sonography. We had a discussion about that. And now, when you are asked about X-ray KUB, now is the time that you could have justified saying that, sir, X-ray KUB sensitivity and specificity is 70%, and plain CT KUB sensitivity and specificity is almost 99% for urolithiasis. And now we have low dose CT protocol. We have non-contrast CT KUB, which can reduce the radiation exposure almost equivalent to an X-ray. So all these things you could have justified and said that, okay, now once you have done the sonography and you are doubting a stone, you could have gone straight for a CT. So when asked like these questions, this is the way you should justify.
So why not CT IVP then?
Yeah, so that you tell me, why not CT IVP?
Sir, that will give us the function of the kidney as well.
Till time, we have not settled with the any diagnostic clue. Okay, so you first of all, you have to ask what is the sonography.
Correct.
When the sonography discussion is going on,
you don't even know the creatinine and you are asking for a contrast CT.
Yeah.
You should have said before asking for CT or X-ray, sir, I would like to know what is on sonography so that I know.
I can plan further investigation as per the report.
Correct.
First sonography, then further investigation. Yes.
So ask for it. Show him.
Hello. Can we get the USGN basic reports?
Yes, sir. On investigation. Investigation suggests of urine routine microscopy, first cell occasional RBC is absent, cast cell absent, HB is 12.2, TLC count 7000, serum creatinine is 1.81, uric acid is 3.24 and serum calcium is 8.87.
And you are showing all the further investigations. Okay.
So now do you want to do CT IVP?
No, sir.
Asking the report and seeing the basic biochemistry is very important before deciding for CT IVP. So if you miss that step, you will get into trouble because now it is 1.8.
Are you surprised at this report?
Many times you have seen that in whenever there is an acute episode, maybe because of dehydration or maybe the reflex non-functioning or decreased function of the opposite kidney, creatinine is raised, or patient might have taken some energy.
Are you enough to give you the answers? So guys, tell me, what all are the causes of raised creatinine now? Manas,
what are the causes?
Sir, first, since she's having pain since 1 month, she might be consuming a lot of painkillers. That might be one of the causes.
Go ahead.
Second, it might be an infection, but the counts are normal. So, and the urine routine is also normal. So that is ruled out. Third thing, we don't know about the kidney status. So the obstructive uropathy itself might be causing the rise in creatinine.
So infection presents with high creatinine?
Sir, it might be if the patient might be landing into urosepsis.
Patient may be a solitary kidney, bilateral obstruction.
Yes, sir.
Already affected in the past, other kidney block. So many.
Yes, I mentioned. A third point I mentioned that we don't know about the kidney status, so might be an obstructed single solitary kidney.
Specific, no?
Yes. Most important thing is you can categorize as a pre-renal. Someone has said very rightly, pre-renal, renal, and post. So what are the pre-renal causes in this case, in this particular case? In this particular case, it can be because of patient is not consuming enough of fluid in last 1 month. It may be because of dehydration. Renal, it can be because of, as you said very rightly, patient might be taking analgesics and overdose of that can also give rise to early CKD. And then post-renal obstruction, it may be a solitary kidney or there may be bilateral stone. Patient may have only one-sided pain, but there may be a stone on other side.
Yes, sir.
Because you don't have any other investigation. So you have to be very clear in your mind. Fine. So now next what? Now what you want? You want X-ray, you want sonography, or you want CT scan?
Sir, I want the sonography. We have done a sonography. I would like to see the sonography reports.
Okay. Yes. Prashant? Can you show?
Sir, we have report. We actually don't have.
Okay. No problem.
Yes,
because we are seeing sonography day and night. So even in this case, if you don't have, it's okay.
Sir, sonography suggests you of bilateral kidneys are normal. There is no any perinephric fast standing. And there is a midureteric stone present with no hydroureter proximal to it. And left sided ureter, bladder normal. No any abnormality detected.
So again, a question remains the same. Why he has a raised creatinine? If there is no hydronephrosis proximal to the stone, that means stone is not obstructing and still his creatinine is 1.8. That means the cause for increasing creatinine is not the obstruction.
Minus.
So most likely,
if you go with the sonography report.
NSAIDs. Yes, sir. Primarily, we can think that the reason in this case may be due to maybe renal due to consumption of overdosing of NSAIDs over the time.
But we don't have that history. There is just a history of 2 episodes of pain.
Agreed.
Overuse of analgesics, you will come to know from history. Further, if there is a renal cause, you should have proteinuria, which you do not have here.
Correct. Yes, sir.
Also, we do not have the baseline creatinine of this patient. So
precisely. So would we be happy with just one report of creatinine?
No, sir.
At least 2 values.
Okay, so yes, we have noted that creatinine is high. We will keep that in mind and we proceed further. Yes, we take this into cognizance to decide our further investigations.
Yes, sir.
And Prashant, I have one comment for you. You said no facts trending. Facts trending is never seen on sonography.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. Yeah.
So never comment fetch standing on sonography, huh? Please.
Yes, sir.
Fetch standing is always seen in the city.
Okay. Fine. So Manas, now this is the history. So now next what?
Sir, meteoritic stone size. Yes, not mentioned.
Yeah, tell us.
It is 9 mm.
Okay. Sir, I would counsel the patient that it's a relatively large calculus, and that the percentage of this stone passing on its own is less than 50%. And I would like to investigate further and do. Sorry,
what is meant by meteoritic?
Sir, adjacent to the SI joint, along.
It should be between the upper border and lower border of SI. Superior border and inferior border of SI. There is no adronym. Size is 9.
Yes, so it's a partially obstructive stone. Which is really...
from kidney to the meteoritic. Patient doesn't have any fever. Patient doesn't have any raised LDL except creatinine.
Yes, sir.
So, is there any role of medical expert?
Yes, sir. 9 mm stone has less than 50% passage rates, spontaneous passage rates. But we can counsel the patient that we have both the options in hand. We can go ahead with conservative management by giving medical treatment and surgical treatment also. Depends on the patient's choice, on the pain, recurrence of the pain, on occurrence of fever, which we do.
Here two
haven't.
Questions can arise. What is the indication of MAT and what are the contraindications for it? When you prefer to place the patient on MAT and when you try to avoid the start MAT, medical expert should be. Because this patient, 37-year-old, no adronephrosis, no raised TLC, no fever, no any internal echoes in the kidney, except 1.8 creatinine, and stone is in the meteorite.
All these reasons are that we can hold on and continue with the medical expulsive therapy, since the stone is relatively 9 mm has still 50% expulsive rate, so...
As patient had a remittent pain in spite of taking a medical treatment.
Remittent pain, if the pain doesn't settle on medication.
Is it a contraindication for medical exposure therapy? Yeah.
If the pain doesn't settle on medication. Yes, sir.
So that's
an indication for. Yes, sir. If it is an upper urethral stone, large stone.
I'm telling that doesn't mean it is indication for him. Whatever you want to say, you have to defend it.
Yes, sir.
So, Manas and Mriganka, in short, what are the indications to intervene?
There are a number of literature which suggest there is a role of alpha blocker in upper urethral stenosis.
Yes.
Yes, sir.
Sir, in informed patients and in tolerable symptoms without UTI and small urethral calculi less than 10 mm, these are the indications.
So can you tell me, suppose patient has got severe pain, continuous pain, and the stone is only 4 millimeter, what you will do?
Sir, that will be a contraindication for MAT.
So you will intervene, correct? You will do the surgery.
Yes, sir.
If the patient has got hematuria, what you will do?
Then
you will go ahead with the surgery or not? If the patient has got infection, if it is showing that there is quite a lot of there is a moderate hydronephrosis.
Right, sir. Yeah,
whether you go ahead or not, if the stone is more than 9 millimeter or 7 millimeter to 8 millimeter,
Yes, sir.
Then if the stone is at the same site for more than 3 weeks.
Then also, yeah.
Then you should know, you must, creatinine is having creatinine derange continuously. You have done 1, 2, 3 serum creatinine. It's still remaining high. You'll go ahead with the surgery or not?
Yes, sir.
And if the blood pressure is high, if the patient comes with a high blood pressure, raised blood pressure, 160, 170 by 100, relatively young patient. So Manas, can you enumerate whatever I said? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6?
Yes, sir. If there is a non-relenting pain, if the pain doesn't settle with painkillers, if there is fever, if there is moderate to severe hydronephrosis on sonography, if there is hematuria, then if the renal function tests are deranged, in all these cases, we should be.
Then, if there is a
fever,
it has got hypertension, blood pressure, normally not known, but now he has got a reason. Or she has got a raised blood pressure and the stone is not moving.
Stone is not moving for more than 3 weeks. Or bigger stone, more than 9 mm stones.
Yeah. So these are the indications.
Yes. And single functioning kidney also.
Solitary kidney.
Lower threshold to intervene.
So it's solitary kidney and bilateral obstruction.
Yes.
And some upper patients are theoretically. Yes. Bilateral and driver.
Ask, sir. Dr. Yes. Pankaj, you want to add something to this?
Sir, I'm absolutely okay with that. I would not really stress on hematuria and hypertension as an indication. But yes, symptomatic, say significant symptoms, UTI, progressive increase in hydronephrosis, progressive deterioration of creatinine, and stone which refuses to migrate over adequate observation. These would be my indications to intervene.
Yeah. No, because couple of patients I have seen, that patient continuously has a hematuria and he is worried. See, for us, it may not be like we know that patient is not, his hemoglobin is not going to come down or patient is not going to become anemic. But patient, they are worried 2, 3, 4 days if this hematuria continues gross, then that is one of the indications.
Person.
Young patient, if the blood pressure is high, I will always keep in mind that it can be because of the renal cause. So I will always like to intervene if the stone is not coming out in 2, 3, 4 days.
So can anybody tell me what is the luminal diameter of ureter at various places?
Manas, you know, Mrigang?
एवरेज कितना रहेगा और एट आइलेट क्रॉसिंग कितना है, पीयूजे को कितना है और वीयूजे को कितना, एटलीस्ट एवरेज तो पता रहना चाहिए. एग्रीड, समवन हैज चार्टेड इन स्टार बॉक्स, इट इज 6 एमएम एंड एट पीयूजे ऑब्लिक वीयूजे इट इज नियर अबाउट 4 एमएम.
सो अनदर क्वेश्चन इज 6 एमएम. या which are the levels of obstruction in ureter, physiological? Manas, can you answer?
Yes, sir. The PUJ, the crossing of air vessels at the PUJ.
And it is, someone may not agree, but there is always kink at the level of L3 in majority of the patients. बहुत बार वहाँ पे किंक मिल जाता है, रीजन आई एग्जैक्टली डोंट नो, बट बहुत सारे पेशेंट में वहाँ पे किंक मिलता है, तो दैट मे बी समटाइम्स कॉमन साइट फॉर किंक दैट एट द लेवल ऑफ L3 L2 L3 के बीच. प्रैक्टिकली क्यों होता है वो तो पता नहीं है, लेकिन रहता है. पंकज सर, आपका कोई ओपिनियन?
आई हैव नॉट रियली ऑब्जर्व दिस, बट आई वुड फील गीता साहब दैट फ्रॉम देयर एग्जाम पॉइंट ऑफ व्यू giving the standard book answers will be better.
Yes, three UJ, VUJ and ILEC crossing. I agree.
And ILEC crossing, yes.
Fine. So now, next investigation, what do you like to do? Manas? Will you like to do X-ray KUV? And if you want to do X-ray KUV, can you justify? Can you reason it out?
Sir, I would like to do CT KUB, but if we have to do X-ray KUB, then maybe due to non-availability of other facilities, of CT scan facilities, we might do an X-ray KUB.
My question is, suppose if you do X-ray and if you can see the stone, and you have also done CT KUB,
yes, can...
the stone is not a, it is about 4 to 5 millimeter, and you want to try medical line of treatment, therapy, medical therapy,
it
then you will do
the
sonography or X-ray KUB if the stone is seen.
Sir, it helps in the follow-up of the patient. If we are managing the patient on medical expressive therapy, then an X-ray KUB can help in the further follow-up of the patients.
Okay. So, Giteji, in exam, one should talk about X-ray or he should not?
Sir, if someone has told X-ray QB, koi unko galat to nahi bolega, kyunki X-ray QB can be defended to know the opacity of the stone. Is it radio opaque or radio lucent? If suppose CT facility is not available, someone is practicing in periphery. Another is then X-ray QB can be used in case of the follow-up post surgery. Because every time we may not do CT in as a follow-up in post surgery. So there is the role of X-ray QAB pre as well as post surgery. It can be different. That may not help in deciding the type of treatment or density of the stone, exactly what is shown in the CT scan. But compared to the bones around, it can be judged it is hard or not hard, proved by crude.
So basically, I think for the follow-up, if you are deciding for medical expulsion therapy, in that case, X-ray KUB may be of help.
Another thing is, sir, CT mein to majority stone, except one or two, I am not remembering what type of day, stones are always visible in the CT. CT is sab dikha deta hai, lekin radio lucent hai ki radio roop pe wo kaisa pata hai. अगर उनको ढूंढना है तो उसके लिए एक्सरे ही एक ऐसी फैसिलिटी है कि जिसमें रेडियो ओपेसिटी डिसाइड करता है. फॉर एग्जांपल 1 सेंटीमीटर का प्यूज स्टोन है और सिटी में दिख रहा है 300 हंस पर यूनिट इन सिटी एंड इफ यू प्लान फॉर एग्जांपल लिथोट्रिप्सी हाउ यू प्लेस लिथोट्रिप्सी इफ यू डजंट हैव एनी अल्ट्रासाउंड स्कैन. सो अगेन देयर इज अ रोल ऑफ एक्सरे क्यूबिक इज रेडियो ओपेसिटी है कि मेजॉरिटी प्लेसेस लिथोट्रिप्सी is done with the use of or fluoroscopy.
So Pankaj bhai, can you just tell them whether you will advise X-ray QB or it is absolutely not indicated?
I would not advise X-ray QB, but as Dr. Gita said, if somebody advises X-ray QB, you cannot really fault him. Today's time and in today's practice, with better investigations available, which have better, say, sensitivity and specificity, there is hardly any role of X-ray KUB as a diagnostic modality.
Yeah, I agree. Okay, only for a diagnosis, it may not be done. But with the diagnosis and for the follow-up.
So, once you have, say, done a CT and found a 1500 Hounsfield unit stone, and then you want to follow this patient up, a X-ray KUB probably is absolutely justified.
Okay. Fine. Okay. I understand.
So, another commonly asked question in case of uretic stone is when only a non-contrast scan suffice and in as investigation for planning the treatment. Or in which type of patient there is no need of doing the contrast CT scan. Forget that 1.8. It's just question.
So in case of ureteric, mid and lower ureteric calculus.
Yes, in case of mid and lower aortic calculus, but provided that the cortical thickness of the kidney on sonography should be adequate and the hydronephrosis should be at mild to moderate. And in particularly in case of pediatric population, a non-contraceptive can suffice in spite of going for CTI.
Okay, sir.
So rather, Dr. Gita, what we should be telling them are the indications for contrast CT rather than when non-contrast will suffice. So we would talk more of reverse, say if patient has significant hydronephrosis, reduced cortical thickness, previous history of surgery, previous failed intervention. These are the patients where I would probably ask for a contrast study. Otherwise, a non-contrast CT could suffice.
I would also, sir, we told them the X-ray KUB is okay for follow-up, but they should also know that most of the studies now want CT KUB to diagnose stone-free status.
Absolutely. And you know, with these low-dose CT scans, that issue of radiation exposure is practically taken care of.
Correct, sir.
So low dose and ultra low dose CT scan, the radiation exposure is practically negligible.
Agree.
Okay.
Is it possible to predict the function of kidney based on a non-contrast CT?
Sir, you are asking.
I'm asking the students, sir, not you,
Dr. Gita. Sir, roughly by the parenchymal thickness, not accurately.
So there are studies which have compared the split function on DTP rhinogram to the split function diagnosed just by a non-contrast CT. There is volumetric studies of renal cortex, and the volumetric studies of renal cortex matches the split function diagnosed by contrast CT. So if you have volumetric analysis there on your CT scan console, then it is possible to predict the precise function of that kidney.
Okay.
This is a good observation. Yeah, go ahead. Just show the X-ray and then show CT. So Manas, is it a mid uretic or it is a upper uretic?
It's an upper uretic, faintly radiopaque calculus. Can see both the kidney shadows and
describe this X-ray KUB.
So it's a well-exposed X-ray KUB, X-ray of the kidney, ureter, and bladder. The lower cut does not include the pubic symphysis. We can see bilateral renal shadows can be appreciated faintly. And a small radiopaque calculus adjacent to L2, L3 vertebra can be seen.
You missed out on the bony architecture. You missed out on the bowel preparation. You missed out
bowel on preparation seems adequate.
You missed out on the exposure. How do you comment on exposure, whether it is good or not?
Sir, well exposed, but the area covered should be more than the pubic. It should cover both the pubic symphysis and the greater of the femur.
And both sides psoas shadows are seen.
Yes, sir. Both sides psoas shadows are seen. That's why it is well exposed.
So it is not X-ray KUB there.
Okay, Prashant, now show them CT KUB.
Yes, sir. One minute, sir. Is it visible, sir?
A static film. Yeah.
Yeah, just show that next pill.
This one?
Bas, yeah. Just show that. Enough. Okay. Yes. Bregan?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, just describe it and tell us now what you want to do.
Sir, CT, KUV showing both the kidney, contralateral kidney, left-sided kidney is also looking normal. There's no obvious fat trending. And there is a single upper uretric right calculi, approximately 1 centimeter. And bladder appears to be normal.
Are you able to define the left ureter on the CT?
Left ureter is not.
At least I cannot appreciate it.
Yes, sir. Not appreciate.
So left ureter is not reconstructed.
Oh.
Fine. So now next. Briganka, this is a case. Now what you want to do?
Sir, I would like to counsel the counsel the patient regarding the options available, like DJ stenting or URSL or RIRS.
No medical treatment. Compare the ureter.
Your first answer is DJ stent. So I'm not happy with your first answer.
Yes, sir. We'd like to.
Why you want to do only DJ stent?
What are the indications to first DJ?
Sir, hydronephrosis and infection, pyelonephritis.
So, in high case, is there any finding suggest of infection? Clinical, palpation, tenderness, ALT raised, urine routine, plenty of first aid, culture shows any infection. Anything is there suggested?
You know the history, you know the lab, you know the CT now. Then you're telling DJ stenting.
Then, dekho, while answering the question, you should answer properly. Because the examiner again may ask you, when will you do only DJ stenting? Then the unnecessary bhava get diverted to some other place. Then 5 nephrosis, infected hydronephrosis, desert TLC, fever, then on placing the uretric catheter, if there is infected urine or first coming from the uretric hook, then number of causes can be given and at that place, but only DJ, we have to do the DJ and come out. If DJ is not going, then we have to place the fish. तो अपना सिंपल सिंपल वाइवा जाने का छोड़ के डाइवर्ट हो जाएगा इधर.
तो एनीवे मानस, कैन यू टेल अस व्हाट आर द डिफरेंट ड्रग्स व्हिच आर यूज्ड फॉर मेडिकल एक्सपल्शन ऑफ द यूरेटिक कैलकुलस?
यस सर. सो वी मोस्ट कॉमनली अल्फा ब्लॉकर्स आर यूज्ड. टैम्सिलोसिन हैज इज यूज्ड एंड अलोंग विद दैट वी give in case of non-acute cases, once the pain is settled, we can also give this diuretic along with alpha blocker.
Let's see. Again, there is a role of diuretic. So
once the pain is settled, if
there is a complete impacted stone and if you prescribe the diuretic to that,
then the pain will increase. Then in those cases, the pain will not settle and the pain might increase on prescribing a diuretic. Sir. So we will avoid in such cases selectively.
What else can happen if the stone is badly impacted and you give diuretic?
So there can be pilitis. Due to reflux.
And it will end up into the pyelocallous shell, pyelovenous leakage and perinephric collection and urine.
Ornithial rupture.
Yes,
there was a paper.
Ornithial rupture can
has occurred and big urinoma is formed.
Yes, sir.
Fine. So we will not give if there is hardly any mild hydronephrosis or no hydronephrosis, no hydrourethra. That means the urine is flowing from the side of the stone. The size of the stone is not more than 7 or 8 millimeter, correct? So, and if there is no severe pain, you can give diuretic. So, second drug is diuretic. Third, what else you can give?
Steroids are used in non-diabetic young patients.
What is the role of steroids?
It decreases the local edema.
Scientifically proved or there is hypothesis?
Sir, it is not proven, but in practice, people it is not a it does not have a proven benefit over alpha blockers.
So again, the way I would answer this question is that although calcium channel blockers, steroids, diuretics have been tried, but the only drug which has shown adequate response is alpha blockers. So just close this chapter as early as you can.
Yes, agree.
Literature is very clear that nothing other than alpha blocker works.
Manas, in
and the reason that is that the alpha receptor present only in the lower majority of the alpha receptor present in the lower ureter and at the level of bladder, they can give receptors in the upper ureter.
Manas, you might not say in practice we are doing this and that because that is level 5 evidence.
Right. Then apart from that, there are papers which shows even early there was stress of peptidase has been used and there are papers showing that it is helpful. And the last one is, I think, there's even tadalafil that is also used and some people have shown the benefit. Beneficial effect. And the last, there was one paper about the ejaculation. That also has, there is one paper on that also. So as Dr. Pankaj Maheshwari said very rightly, these are the different drugs or methods, but the most effective and the proved one is in alpha block.
Only proven benefit is of alpha blockers.
Yeah. Fine. So Manas, will you like to give medical therapy in this patient?
Sir, first of all, did the pain settle after the pain after the patient arrived at the casualty? Did the pain settle on the with the painkillers and what all did you have to give?
This patient had pain 1 week back and she has come to your OPD. She has not come to you.
Okay, sorry. Sorry, sir. I didn't know. I missed that. We can. It's a 9 mm. What is the size of the stone on the CT scan, which is more specific? I would like to know, sir. And, 11
mm. And 1200 Hall's unit.
Sir, I would like to counsel the patient that the stone is in the upper ureter and the size is more than 9 mm and the chances of these stones passing spontaneously or even with medical expulsive therapy are low. And I would counsel the patient that most probably he will definitely need surgery even if we go ahead with the medical expulsive therapy. Since the creatinine is high in this case, I would inform the patient that we should get the surgery done as we should get the procedure done at the earliest instead of waiting.
So, Mriganka, what is your say on this?
We can give a medical trial, then along with antibiotics, then if that doesn't passes out then we can go ahead with intervention.
Now the patient has got history of last 1 month.
Why do you want to give antibiotics?
Sir, prof- uh, be- to prevent sepsis, urosepsis?
You see, antibiotics is not a part of, say, protocol for medical expensive therapy. Do you
see any lithuria you want to operate? And if you want, if you say that before that you want to give antibiotic, it is justified, but not in the thing medical expression therapy where there is no infection.
Okay.
So there is a question from your friends. In this case, can you wait for 1 week with medical expulsion therapy?
Manas, patient says
yes,
that
yes, sir, we can. After having counseled the patient, we can start medical expulsion therapy and wait for 1 week with the follow-up of, since the HUA is 1200, it will be visible on the X-ray. So an X-ray KUB and a repeat creatinine after 2 days, even if the patient, we are continuing on medical expulsive therapy, I would like to repeat the creatinine after 2 days. And okay. Decide further.
Fine. Now this stone is not moving. Patient has got recurrent pain and patient has come to you in OPD again. Now what will you do?
Sir, I will counsel him for counsel her for surgery and plan accordingly.
So, what?
I've explained how will
you yes, sir. What advice so, you will give?
Sir, I will counsel the patient that we have to do since there is no primary infection and we can go ahead with the primary laser URSL and I will also counsel the patient that we will essentially need to keep a DJ stent post procedure which we can mostly be keeping for 2 to 3 weeks and the removal will be another small procedure and the chances of the stone we having to the primary treatment being successful but in some cases the stone fragments may pass into the upper ureter or into the upper calyx or into the kidney where we have to follow and the definitive treatment can be done later. Third thing, in some cases which we might not be able to maneuver through the VUJ or into the ureter, if we are unable to bypass the then in those cases we might not be able to do a primary URS and we might only stent and come out and do the primary procedure later on after the ureter has relaxed.
So my only one question is why only laser lithotripsy?
Sir, because it is an upper ureter stone and by using laser, we will have lesser chances of retropulsion of the stone.
Suppose patient says, I don't want any intervention. Can you do lithotripsy on me?
Sir, lithotripsy in the upper, in ureteric stones does not have good clearance rates and treat. So I will inform the patient regarding the stone.
Manas, I don't think this sentence is correct.
As per which literature it is what you are saying is correct. Upper ureteric stone up 1 centimeter size and 1 centimeter PUJ stone with if it is indicated and in the range of indication of PSWL has same equivalent.
Correct. And you also said that if stone migrates, I will tell the patient at a later date, we will do something. Why later date? If you have lithotripsy, maybe you can
offer. We can do it in the same. Yeah, we can do it in the same setting also. But the...
Yes, you can say that I will attempt to do a flexible. And yes, and why upper ureteric stone lithotripsy cannot be done?
Rather, Manas, the advantages of lithotripsy will be that you will not need a stent.
Correct.
The first plan of treatment should be lithotripsy. If you want, please contradict me. If you have why do you think what I'm saying is not correct?
Manas, answer. Mriganka, you can also answer.
It's a 1 centimeter stone and 1200 HU. So the breakage rates will be less with lithotripsy.
Patient is okay taking 2 sittings.
He will require multiple sittings, but the stone clearance rates.
So if you want to depend on yourself, there are literature which suggests that with the Hansel unit of stone, if it is more than 750 in few papers, if it is more than 1000 in few papers, the fragmentation rate with the lithotripsy is not good. That's why the lithotripsy in this particular patient is I am not preferring, because his Hansel unit is 1200. ऐसा बोल के वहां से निकल जाना है, अटकना।
So in this patient, I would feel there would be only two situations, or rather three situations, where I would not really consider ESWL. One is the high Hounsfield unit. Second will be if the patient is very obese or obviously in pregnancy. Barring these three situations, if there is no infection, no significant heteronephrosis, normal creatinine, my first line of treatment will be ESWL.
Okay.
So Mriganka, what you do normally in your hospital?
Sir, we generally use pneumatic lithotripsy.
Okay.
Put a digester.
But I see there are definitely indications, but in this case there is no hydroureter, and I think in exams, because most of the examiner nowadays, they are not doing ESWL lithotripsy, and first choice for most of the urologists, even though Dr. Pankaj Maheshwari has said very rightly, lithotripsy can be one of the, you know, choice, the primary choice, but most of the people are doing ureteroscope. When such a stone comes, so they are always going ahead with the lithotripsy, URS. So I think in exam, if you are doing lithotripsy, well and good. If you are not going doing it, I think URS can be justified.
2-3 options, sir. URSL with DJ plus minus lithotripsy if I doesn't have flexible NDS. That is one option. Another option.
Even if it migrates, then RIRS. If the stone goes up, then you can do RIRS.
Another option is URS with flexible scope. If it migrates, also doesn't matter. And primary basic lithotripsy, sir, with 1200 Hounsfield unit, probably in exam, also difficult to depend on. Because literature bhi 1000 se aage fragmentation rate kaafi kam hai. Lekin kuch machines hai jo fragmentation dete hai. Jaisa hamara Aurangabad mein ek machine tha, so that result is good with even if 1200 Hounsfield unit. So variation, it is depend upon the type of machine, amount of pain, sensitivity of the tolerance of the patient. Then size of the stone, intensity of the stone. As a 3-4 factors to super fragmentation depend. But better in exam, if someone tell like the semi-rigid ureteroscope, upper ureter ke liye use kyun karte hai, aisa bhi question aa sakta hai. If semi-rigid ureteroscope is only made for the mid ureter and lower ureter. In spite we are using right and left of semi-rigid ureteroscope right up to the pelvis. But flexible URS with laser is the ideal answer to this patient. Another answer is URS with semi-rigid ureteroscope with DJ with some fragments went up, either followed by RIRS or lithotripsy. That is another option. That's what I think.
Manas, you said that with lithoclast, it will there is chance of retropulsion. So yes, is there any chance with retropulsion with laser?
Yes, sir. Holmium laser has higher retropulsion rates than thulium laser.
Very good.
Also. Yes.
Thulium laser. Dr. Maheshwari, my one question is, can someone say that if the stone migrates, then I will do mini PCNL?
Mini PCNL for such a small stone. बोल सकते हैं सर, बट प्रोबेबली नॉट जस्टिफाइड. Suppose if I have all the facilities, then if the stone migrates, I would do a flexible uterectomy or ESWL and not really mini PCL.
Because mini PCL again would require laser. So if you have laser, probably you will have a flexible.
And second, Manas, I think you spoke about thulium laser. Don't call it thulium laser. Call it thulium fiber laser.
Thulium fiber laser. Yes, sir.
Yes, because sir.
Thulium laser is different and thulium fiber is different.
Yes, sir. It's a thulium fiber laser. Sorry.
Yeah. Okay. So now, Manas, what we have understood is that in some selected cases, in this case, you can offer ESWL. It has got advantage because you are not going to do digital stenting. But if there is no hydroureter, correct? And if you are not able to locate it on X-ray, if the patient is either very thin or the patient is fat, obese, and the patient has got any other contraindication like pregnancy, you may not do ESWL. So the next choice is, as Dr. Gite said, that flexible.
Yes,
you RIRS or ureteroscopy, because some people may tell you that why in the upper ureter you want to do ureteroscopy. So you can say flexible. And the last will be if it migrates, then either RIRS, ESWL, or you can do mini PCL. Fine. So now what you will like to do? What is routinely done in your hospital?
Sir, we counsel the patient for RIRS or ESWL. Most commonly for this patient, we can, since the HU is 1200, so we'll counsel for RIRS. But if the dilatation of the ureter is not much and we are unable to dilate the ureter, then we also counsel for a staged procedure.
Okay, Mriganka, what is your choice?
We will counsel the patient for the stage procedure if required. And also we can at least counsel regarding the semi-rigid ureteroscope and try with.
Pankaj, what do you think? I think it is worth the thing. I mean, you can say semi-rigid ureteroscopy in this case.
Sir, it's a lady, so semi-rigid ureteroscopy should be possible. But you should say, I would do ureteroscopy with, laser lithotripsy. And Manas, don't talk about stage procedure at this time. The question come for this. Okay, so your plan at this time is that, okay, I want to treat this patient by ureteroscopy. I would keep both flexible and rigid ready. If you can reach by flexible, rigid, good. Otherwise, you use flexible. If it gets pushed back, you use flexible. Stop at this. Now, what all things you would explain to the patient? I would explain that rarely he may need to be pre-stented. The indications of pre-stenting will be if I find the ureter which is not capacious for my excess sheath, or if I find purulent urine above the stone. So these will be the two indications where I stent and come again after some time.
Yes, sir.
Fine. So which ureteroscope you like to use, Mriganka?
Sir, 6 by 7.5 French. Semi-rigid.
Okay.
Or...
So what should be the answer? Maheshwari?
6 by 7.5 is okay, sir. That's a workhorse ureteroscope. But I would accept this answer.
Yeah, I think routinely all of us, and that is what we are normally doing.
Yes.
So I think that should be the right answer. And if you can't...
then you can have the 4.5 French ureteroscope.
Yeah. Fine. So already we have talked about the energy also, what energy and if it migrates, what we are going to do. Fine. So then, Manas, you like to put the DJ stand?
Yes, sir. In all, yes, sir. I would like to put it in this.
So which size?
सर 5.5 और 6 फ्रेंच डिजेस्टेंट
मानस बताइए ना लेंथ भी बताइए ना
लेंथ सर Depending on
she is a female.
The
she is
height
Indian
of the
female.
Patient,
she is an Indian.
24 centimeters.
You said 5.5.
Yes, sir.
Same here. Even I have never used a 5.5.
Budget is
4.5.
5.5
Yes.
How will you decide? Can you decide on sonography?
On X-ray, not on all these digital X-rays,
because nowadays they make it such a small X-ray and give it to you, then it is not possible. If it is done routine, normal size X-ray, then you may be able to predict that what size length you want to use. Fine. So how many days you like to keep it, Manas?
Sir, at least 2 weeks.
What is the hypothesis? Why not 5 days? Why not 7 days? Why 2 weeks? Why not 4 weeks, 5 weeks?
Sir, it's a foreign body, so we would like to remove it at the earliest after it is served its purpose.
And now you are putting second foreign body.
Yes, sir. So to prevent post-procedure edema from blocking the ureter.
Prevent edema. So yes, if you put digest, then edema will not happen.
It will bypass that area of surgery, sir. So where the primarily, there are chances of edema.
You're not preventing it.
No, we are not preventing it, but we are bypassing the ureter till the time the edema settles down.
So then, from where the urine will come out?
Sir, maximum when a stent is in situ, maximum urine comes from by the side of the stent, 70%, and 30% comes through the stent.
Okay.
So,
parameter
70
and 30.
Sir and Campbell.
Achha, okay.
Just find out, and next time you just put it on a group. Huh?
Yes, sir. I will.
Yeah. Okay. Fine. So why you are saying 2 weeks or 10 days? What is the reason? What is the hypothesis behind that?
Sir. Two weeks is for whatever fragments to pass out and for the edema to settle down. 2 weeks, 10 to 14 days is a good time. I do not have any references.
No, you tell us. No, 1, 2, 3, 4. So first of all, because of the edema will settle down in 48 to 72 hours.
Yes, sir.
Correct.
Yes, sir.
Then if you keep it for more than 10 days, again, the ureter will become dilated, petrolous, and whatever, if you remove, if the small fragments, if they are remaining behind, it will come out. Now, all these things, you are going to put it for 10 days to 15 days if you have not injured the ureter.
Yes, sir.
Any doubt, you'll keep it longer, 3 to 4 weeks.
Okay, sir.
So Dr. Maheshwari, Hiren, what is your say on this? How many days they should say, and what is the reason behind that?
Ideally, if there is no trauma, I don't think that more than 7 days is justified. If you just want to be on the safe side and there was some edema due to the stone, then I think 7 to 10 days is more than enough. Otherwise, I don't think that there's any role for keeping for 4 weeks, 6 weeks. There's people just decide empirically.
I think I agree with that. If there is no trauma, everything is smooth. Within 7 to 10 days, you can remove.
The longer you keep, there is a formation of biofilm over the stent and the risk of infection significantly increases. And you really do not give any advantage to the patient by keeping the stent any longer. So in a non-complicated URS, if you decide to keep a stent, then stent should come out within 7 to 10 days.
Correct.
Yeah. Fine. So when you're stenting this patient, so how will you, what medicines you like to give? Yes, Mriganka, can you answer?
Sir, we will give antibiotic as well as to reduce the stent symptom, we can give some alpha blockers.
Okay, and?
And counsel and keep ask the patient to stay hydrated at least 2.5 to 3 liters per day.
Okay, but what is the role of solifenacin means antimuscarinic?
Yes, sir, to reduce the
reduce what? So okay, now tell me, what are the causes of stent colic? Manas, can you tell me what is stent colic and why it occurs?
Sir, due to high pressure in the bladder, reflux of urine into the peristaltic system increases the pressure and it can cause.
So, what is the stent colic?
Stentic
reflux of.
What is the stent colic? So with the stent inside, when the patient passes urine, what happens?
Sorry,
the patient she will get a pain in?
There is pain at the renal angle.
Yeah. Now what are the causes?
Sir, irritation at the trigone and reflux. Reflux of urine and irritation of the.
Why there is reflux of urine? Why there is reflux of urine?
Sir, because the VUJ is bypassed.
So?
VUJ is bypassed and it's an open-ended stent. So, there is no. And there is high pressure in the bladder. So, it refluxes.
Valve mechanism is gone.
Pardon?
Valve mechanism.
Okay, so it can come from the side of the stent.
Yes, sir.
What is the capillary effect?
Capillary.
What is the movement of the stent?
Yes.
As you said, it is irritating the trigonal area.
Yes, sir.
So the bladder goes
that
into spasm.
Stent dysuria it causes also.
Dr. Maheshwari, can you just elaborate on that? So in exam, what they should they say?
I'm sorry, I was not concentrating.
The question is, what is stent colic and what are the causes of that?
Stent colic, no, I would not be able to answer. Hiran, you want to take this?
Basically, sir, what he said is, because of the stent, they are having multiple bladder problems. So I think it is more of a bladder spasm than the stent colic. Unless the stent has migrated down into the ureter, then they could have some.
Basically, the stent colic is whenever the patient passes urine and he has got a stent, he will get a pain in the flank region. And the reasons given behind that, one is that the spasm of the irritation of the trigonal area and the spasm, which pushes the stent up and down. Second thing is the reflux of the urine. Primarily, it is because that valvular mechanism is not functioning. So, from the side, the urine can go back into the kidney and the sudden gush of urine and causing the dilatation of the pelvic LSL system, stretching, can give rise to this pain. And the last thing is, they are saying even with the capillary effect, because this tent is so small in size that even with the capillary effect, the some amount of urine goes there. So probably these are the causes. Anyone wants to elaborate more, or if you have read more, please let us know.
No, these causes you said are correct, sir. This is basically with that stent spasm or bladder spasms, I think they get. But sometimes they get come in severe colic because of stent when that is migrated into the ureter. Then they come
okay.
colic infection.
Yeah, that's what the movement of the stent. It may not have gone totally inside, but the movement, you know, yes. and when it is moved, and that is the reason they say not to use a long stent. Use the proper size stent so that all these symptoms are avoided. So what is the medicine for? What is the treatment for that?
Sir, solifenacin.
Okay.
To prevent overactive bladder.
Yeah. Okay. Fine. So what happens if you keep the stent a little longer?
So encastration may result
in... So we are talking about now Ferguson stent. So what precaution you will take now? You tell me. Manas and Briganka, in your hospital, what are the steps to avoid?
Yes. To counsel the patient and to make him aware that stent must be removed. Otherwise, it will get encastrated.
So, okay. So, preoperatively, you have counseled the patient that you are going to put a stent during surgery also, and after surgery also, you have counseled him and you have told him that you have put a stent inside and he has to come for the removal. But that is, you have already said. Now, next what?
Sir, ask him to stay well hydrated.
No, and... I am talking about to avoid forgotten stent.
Yes, sir. To maintain a register, sir, in the...
So, in hospital, you make a register. Yeah. You and make a register and write down his name and you write down the stent. Next what? Yes,
and...
You made a register. What else? So, what you'll do with the register? You'll just... Every day you'll see it and you'll feel happy. How many stenting you've done?
We will give him a card or... also, nowadays, smart apps are available where they remind.
Very good. So, one is the app, or if you are making a register, you have to telephone him. And yes. in USA, they are saying that minimum 3 calls. Before yeah. that, if you have not done that much, you are not informed patient, then it is the urologist and the hospital's fault.
Yes.
So, you have to make an effort. So what is the effort? At least 3 telephone. Either you can telephone him, you can email him, or you can SMS him.
Yes.
So these are the 3 different ways. Okay?
Yes.
To remind him that he has to come back for the stent removal. So fine. Either you can have a register or you have a smart app available. But he is not having these facilities.
And postal address.
Yeah, fine. So you have to have a postal address and you have to tell. Right. What else? What else you can do? Manas?
No, sir. I don't.
See, another thing is when patient is getting discharged, okay. You give him again second admission note and you write down that after 2 weeks in your OT book or whatever it is, that there is a stent removal of this patient. So you have given him admission note and you have enrolled him in operation theater. So one day before, your secretary or someone will definitely inform. And the patient also has got that admission sheet. So he knows that he has to come for the digest stent removal. This is one of the techniques they are doing in UK.
I am following that, sir. Whenever I have done a non-complicated URS, I give the date immediately on that day only, on the day of the URS.
Yeah. So when the patient is getting discharged, you are again giving him admission note. You noted it down in your OT book with the telephone number. So automatically, even if you have not kept the register, one day prior, you inform that patient that you have to come for a procedure. Dr. Pankaj Maheshwari, anything else?
He's on the call, sir. He's on a call.
Gita, sir, you want to add anything for the forgotten stand? How to prevent? I think in our country, I have found out this is one of the best things that you give admission check at the time of discharge.
What we were following in our institute is we have made one stamp. It is in the language of the patient, that is in Marathi as well as in Hindi.
Okay.
So it will, the stamp is of 3 lines, suggesting that there is a stain inside your body. That should be removed within so and so period. If it is not removed, it may get into the complications like kidney failure. And if you are not removal of stain is the responsibility of yourself. Aisa karke pura discharge card pe stamp laga dete. That is one. Another thing is we were maintaining the register, stain register.
Exactly.
Every time, whenever there is a if it is 6 weeks, the daily resident will see that date and the kitna logo ko phone karna hai to phone number rehta hai, phone kar dete ki your stain removal time come. If उसने उठाया तो ठीक है नहीं उठाया तो अपनी तरफ से लिख देते हैं कि लिख कर दिया है
राइट सो नाउ इन यूएसए सर दे से देयर आर 3 इंपॉर्टेंट थिंग वन इज एजुकेशन यू एजुकेट द पेशेंट अबाउट अस नंबर 2 इंफॉर्मेशन सो यू आर इंफॉर्मिंग द पेशेंट दैट ही हैज गॉट अ स्टैंड एंड व्हाट आर द कॉम्प्लिकेशंस कैन टेक प्लेस एंड व्हेन ही इज सपोज्ड टू कम. And the last is reminder. So these are the 3 different things about the stent one has to remember. Education, information, and reminder. So when the patient is discharged, you have already educated him and you have informed him. Okay. But reminder is what the surgeon has to do. So please remember that. You can't escape nowadays from that medical legal liability. If you say that I have informed the patient, I have educated patient, I have said everything, it is his fault that he has not come, it will not be accepted. You have to remind him. Okay? And that reminding may be either by letter or it can be by SMS or by telephone or it may be now WhatsApp or email. So now, Manas, last thing, suppose yes, the sir. Patient comes after 1 year with a stent inside, in situ, what you will do?
Long duration stent might have encrustations. First thing which I have
so
to
what
ensure.
You do
sir, I will advise.
Patient says that, sir, I have got urine tract infection. I got sonography done and it is showing there is a stent inside.
Okay. So the sonography has shown a stent inside. So I would like to rule out any encrustations by doing a CT scan because the encrustations might be low density and may not be seen on an X-ray, plain X-ray KUB. So I would like to do a CT scan, plain CT scan KUB.
So
proceed further accordingly.
Okay. Again, there is a role of X-ray because I believe that X-ray should also be done. Because there are chances that in CT scan, you may not be able to see, like, you know, reconstruction may not be there. You don't know that whether, where are the different places on the ureter, there are like, you know, big encrustation. So I always do CT along with the X-ray QB. Again, it is debatable. So you've done CT scan, it is showing that there is a big encrustation or stone formation in the pelvis and in the bladder, and even the ureter is showing the same thing. Now, how will you manage this? Yes, Mriganka.
Sir, in this scenario, we will counsel the patient that infestation has happened, so he might or she might require lithotripsy, or even PCNL might be required, depending upon the extent of infestation. So we will go ahead with.
If there is the encrustation only on the ureter, and that also not much, they say that ESWL may be of a great help, and you can, after doing that, you can try to just remove the stent. But it is very difficult. So in this case, this patient will require multiple procedures. He will require definitely like a systolithotripsy. Then you might have to do URS and go along the ureter and do lithotripsy to break the encrustation, and then for us encrustation or the stone formation in the pelvis, you might have to do PCNL.
Okay.
Dr. Gite Hiren, you want to add anything?
No, sir. I think you covered it.
Yeah. Gite, sir, anything else is left?
No, sir.
I think it's a very simple case. We are going to do lithuria and rural stones and vesical stones, everything again and again. So that time, if anything is left, we can cover. Right? Okay.
Yes.
Yeah. Fine.
Okay.
Okay.
Sir,
thank you.
Just one thing. There is a one paper in Indian Journal of Urology. Describing the stent related symptoms, their etiology and management. Good paper. So the students can go through it. I have just placed the name of the paper. Yeah.
Okay.
Okay.
So you can put it on a PG update also, so they can just go through that.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. Thank you. Good night, everybody.
Night, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Good.